What's going on, everybody? Feels weird to be back. I technically took a week off of filming last week. I did have a pre-recorded video on Do Specific Book Editions Matter, and the discussion was actually really awesome. I really appreciated all of the suggestions for specific book editions that might be better than others, or introductions that are included in specific editions that I would be interested in. You all had great suggestions, and I really appreciate you all taking part in that discussion while I was gone. But while I was away, I did get some reading done. I'm about 257 pages into Thomas Pynchon's Mason and Dixon, and obviously that has to do with the two explorers that created the Mason and Dixon line. They surveyed the land using astronomy to create the border between two states. I believe it's Maryland, Pennsylvania. Don't judge me if that's wrong, but the thing is I'm that far and I only just got to America, so this is a fairly long book, and I think I got tagged in the slow read tag, books that you should read slowly, and if I had to give one answer, it would definitely be this one. I'm excited to finish this up and do a review for it, but I do think it'll take a little while, so I want to revisit some of the books that I read during BookTubeathon that was 2 weeks ago for anybody that didn't participate. But for those of you that did, you know that there were a lot of challenges that we had to complete, and so that also equated into more books being read in a specific week. And so I hit 7 that week and had a few books that I wanted to touch on just a little bit more, because I felt that the short quips that I had at the time didn't quite do them justice. So that's going to be the video for today. I think I'm only going to choose 2 of the books from BookTubeathon that I read, one of them being Watchmen, which will come a little bit later. But today I'm going to look specifically at The Dharma Bums by Jack Kerouac.
The Dharma Bum is me.
When I first talked about the book, I had 2 different views about the narrative, one that was a little more positive and one that was a little more negative. But I want to clear those up a little bit, because I think just leaving it with those 2 points that I made didn't quite get to the entire scope of this novel. And so The Dharma Bums was published in 1958, and I think that that date is very important, and I don't think that was mentioned earlier on in that review. But for a lot of people, they already know that Jack Kerouac was a part of the Beat Generation, and they've kind of heard that connotation there, Jack Kerouac, the Beat Generation, but not necessarily the context. I feel like the 1960s gets a lot more coverage in mainstream America. There have been shows like Mad Men that have covered the entire span of the 1960s, but all of that counterculture that happened at that time didn't just come out of nowhere. Jack Kerouac, along with other writers like Allen Ginsberg and William Burroughs, started this new literary movement where they started to explore new ideas and really turn the literary world on its head. They tried new styles, and one that was particularly used in The Dharma Bums was this kind of free-flowing writing style that Jack Kerouac uses to really capture the moments that he's in with a lot of clarity. He makes sure that there isn't a lot left out, because he's doing it in that spur-of-the-moment way. He gets to the core of a lot of these social circumstances. He doesn't have a lot of editing where it gets in the way of really recording what's going on around him. I think that's something that turns a lot of people off to his writing, because it is so free-flowing. They think that it's a little messy, and there are instances where people say that his writing could use more editing. But the thing is, I think that that helps capture this time period particularly well. And that leads to one of the cool things about The Dharma Bums that a lot of people don't know. The Dharma Bums is actually a historical fiction It's about Jack Kerouac and a lot of the people that he surrounded himself with in the mid-1950s. So even though this was published in 1958, a lot of the events were happening previous to that, and these events were actually happening previous to his big breakout with On the Road. The thing is, Jack has talked about this in previous interviews. He wasn't allowed to use the real names of these people. His publishers actually kind of influenced him to not do that. They thought that it would affect his sales particularly. And so he used a lot of different names for people that he was close with, and even a different name for himself. In this book, it actually ended up being Ray Smith. So in my initial blurbs on the Dharma Bums during the BookTube-a-thon wrap-up video, I said one of the things that really annoyed me was the conversations that were happening among all of the different characters in the Dharma Bums. I thought that they were kind of full of themselves. I thought that there was a lot of false wisdom that they were passing along to one another, and a lot of these hyperboles of being like, this was the greatest thing ever, or he said the greatest thing, and they all just happened to believe each other a little too readily. But upon learning a little bit more about some of the events that happened in this book, some of those hyperboles actually make some sense. For instance, there's a poetry reading that all of the main characters go to earlier on in the book, and when I first heard about it, I just thought it was kind of this thing where all of these people were getting together, thinking that they were super hip, reading these poems to one another. And Ray, when he gets out, he was too shy to actually go up on the stage to read any poems, but he was drunk and he was shouting out a lot of encouragement to everybody else that did get up on the stage. And after it was over, he said, "That was one of the greatest poetry readings I have ever been to." And so when I looked that up, it actually was based on a real event. It was the Six Gallery Reading in 1955 in San Francisco. And it was an event where Allen Ginsberg, who in this book is Alva Goldbook, actually first presented his incredibly famous poem, Howl. And in the book, they actually call it Whale. And it is described as a poem that really got the crowd going. It was something that really excited people. And when you look at the history of this Six Gallery reading, it was the start of this new literary movement that was focused in San Francisco and really spread from there. It kind of solidified San Francisco as this really cultured place. And if you know a bit about history from the 1960s, it's where a lot of the countercultural events started to happen in the mid to late 60s. And a lot of that was really started here at the Six Gallery Reading. And so him saying that it's the greatest poetry reading he had ever been to, he might actually be right. There was also the character Jaffe Ryder, who was actually a real life person called Gary Snyder. And he is a huge part of this book. It's somebody that Jack/Ray Smith really looked up to, and it was this kind of heroic character, somebody who was kind of like a demigod to Ray, and he liked to follow along with whatever Jaffe was doing, whether it be going out into the wilderness or really diving deep into these different religious studies. He just thought that everything that Jaffe was doing was the thing to do. And it turns out Jaffe was one of the people that was at the Six Gallery reading. And like I said, it was a huge countercultural moment. And he was one of the five poets that was up on the stage reading their work. And so when you start to think about Ray's infatuation with Jaffe, and at first it seems like it's kind of weird, well, he was kind of this larger-than-life character that was able to influence a whole group of people just from this one event. And so again, you kind of get to get a glimpse into the minds of these cats during this time if you start to do a little bit of research. That all being said, there still were some really eye-roll-inducing moments, and a lot of these characters did have a lot of false knowledge, and they all were leaning toward these Buddhist teachings and really internalizing them. But it didn't seem like they were following these Buddhist practices to the full extent that they were supposed to be followed. They took these ceremonies that were really used for intensely religious purposes in Buddhist practice, and they kind of turned it into an orgy, and it wasn't necessarily for these religious purposes. It kind of did lead into these more misogynistic practices from these guys that was a little cringy, in all honesty. And that's the thing, is there is no editing of these moments, and so you kind of got the true scope of what was going on. And so it was kind of unfortunate to see that even though they were all trying to be really great people and really have this balanced life, there were still these events that were coming in because they were misinterpreting the main lessons that they were trying to get out of Buddhism. And then you get later on in the book, and a lot of characters start saying things like, well, what Buddhism means to me. And while that is kind of a fair and valid thing to say, what that religion or what that practice means to you, that's fair. They didn't seem to take a lot of the text that they were supposed to be studying seriously, and they just kind of put their own interpretations on it. And so throughout the whole thing, everybody's trying to look for this enlightenment, but they're getting so misguided from each other and from their own random interpretations. And so that is a lot of the reason why I found some of these characters to be a little overbearing. But overall, if you can get past that, there are some interesting lessons to get out of it, and it's kind of cool to see how a lot of these ideas started to form what would later be the hippie movement of the 1960s. And so that's why I think that despite all of those weird things with the characters, it's worth reading just to kind of see where a lot of those counterculture ideas started, and so you can kind of get a better sense of history overall. And now that leads to the parts of the book that I actually did enjoy through and through. Like I had said in my BookTubeathon wrap-up before, there was an absolutely beautiful passage of Ray and Jaffe climbing up the Matterhorn over on the West Coast. And it kind of feels like it was this climax to a first part of the novel. Even though it's not really split into parts, it really feels like this is so significant that there's everything that happened before this climb and then everything that happened afterward, like when Ray went off on his own. But the writing style that Jack Kerouac employs here is amazing. Like I said, it's this really free form where there's not a lot of editing, and I think he does a great job with this. He makes sure to capture this entire environment that they're in. You can see the trail that they're on. You can visualize the forests that they had to go through to get to the trailhead. You can picture that final part of the climb when they're trying to get to the peak. You really get a feeling for that fear that Ray has when he's trying to get up to the peak. And I just thought that this writing style mixed perfectly with the natural settings in this book. That hike for Ray was a hugely transformative moment, and even though he wasn't able to be the perfect person that he was hoping to be when he isolated himself in nature and got away from the city life, which is a huge theme of this book, that split between the natural world and the city that these characters find themselves in, he was still able to feel this connection to the natural world, and it spurs on this trip that he's going to take to get to his parents' house across the country. The beautiful writing continues as Ray gets on trains, as he hitchhikes, as he passes rivers, as he's walking through forests, and when he finally gets to the northeast to see his family. You really feel like you've taken this journey with him, and I think that, again, that is a huge plus for this book. Even though some of the characters can get on your nerves a little bit, when you get to these moments where you are traveling through either the wilderness or you're traveling across the country, you just feel a part of this rucksack revolution that they talk about. And I had said this before, but it is totally understandable that there were so many people that were enraptured with this writing. And I haven't read On the Road, but I imagine that there are similar themes and similar styles of writing that relate to the Dharma Bums. But you could totally see why people would take part in this lifestyle after reading the book. It's something that seems so enticing, and it's just pulls you out of wherever you are and puts you in that journey and makes you want to take it yourself. Now, there's certainly more to this book, but I'm going to leave it at that. I definitely think you should pick this up if you haven't read The Dharma Bums before. If you haven't read Jack Kerouac, it was my first, as I've said. But even though this wasn't for the challenge of read a book in a day, I did pretty much read this in a day because I was in a time crunch. And though it may take longer than a day, it shouldn't be too bad. It's close to 200 pages. And the intro of the edition that I have is very revealing. It kind of talks about Jack's history and the history of the BEAT movement and has both the positives and the negatives of the book. And it's worth it to check that out. I don't know if it's online, but it's The Introduction by Anne Douglas. And so definitely pick this up if you can. Just be ready to get through scenes like this. Ray, I think you drink a little too much. Wanna get drunk? But I thought the ending was beautiful. The scenic descriptions were just out of this world. It was something that made me so jealous, and I was glad that I got to go out to Colorado to experience some great views myself. But that's The Dharma Bums, and let me know what you think. If you've read Jack Kerouac before and you think that you have a suggestion of what I should read next, leave it below. If you have any questions for me about the book, let me know. But for now, I'm trading the mid-1900s in for the mid-1700s. Wish me luck. I'll catch you next time.